It's Kara. This is Crusader Kings 2. I'm here in the Mongol Empire because I want to explain and hopefully give you some tips, tricks, and just like a general understanding of how this thing works. I'm going to be looking at the most like, what the f*** is even going on in this game part of Crusader Kings 2, which for me personally is like the nomadic government type. What is this? What is this? What is this? Like, it looks confusing, right? Like, it looks super confusing from the outset. And I think that's just because this is, like, clearly the most different part of Crusader Kings 2. There's a bunch of new mechanics. There's a bunch of different stuff you have to worry about. I'm gonna explain everything first, and then I'll move to a smaller character. The thing about nomads that's very particular to nomads is that they don't care about holdings, really. They care about land. The more land you have as a nomad, the more power you have. Just in general, that's how it goes. Like, obviously, smaller areas can have more power depending on what they do. But in general, you don't care about building cities. You don't care about building temples or anything like that. Even though you can build temples if you want, what you really want is just as much land as possible. And what that land does for you, it gives you manpower and it gives you population. Population and manpower have sort of like a contradictory relationship. It's kind of confusing. I don't think the details of it matter. But just think of these two things as like more specific forms of currency, which then you can use to do different things. Like, manpower also gives you taxes. It also gives you the ability to create more troops through the horde, which is how you will be creating like a lot of troops. From my experience, this is pretty much the way you will get troops. You want to have enough money or prestige or even faith, and you want to get enough manpower to be able to form hordes. A second thing to realize about nomad type governments is that because they don't care about holdings, battles are like super important. The way you win wars is basically you fight a couple of battles. I mean, this is nomad versus nomad, right? You basically win a couple of battles, you take their capital, and that's it. You need to be very careful to just not get into any battles that you're not sure that you can win. I know that sounds obvious for like everybody. It's just that battles are like way more important than it would be for like a feudal government or whatever, because you still need to take a lot of territory in order to win a war. But if you're a nomadic government, you need to focus on battles. And then after you win enough battles, just like take their capital. That's pretty much all you can do. So really, it's not all that much different from playing any other type of government. You want to focus on like expanding your power, gaining alliances, things like that. But definitely the most like, what the f*** part of this is this screen. At least for me, it's like, what is even going on here? So the way that it works is that you will want to give parts of your land to different people. These can be normal vassals, like this is a normal vassal over here, he's feudal, or they can also be clans, and the number of clans you can have is dependent on, you know, the number of counties in your realm, things like that. But if you have families, it's just like they're vassals with like a more direct relationship to you, if that makes sense. So every clan sort of has like their own title. The clan itself has a relationship to you and a specific number of holdings. It has a leader. Its leader's relationship to you can be different. You'll get the hang of it if you like mess around with it a little bit. Like, there's not much I can say about this. It's just like, just look for this specifically, like clan land demand. If you're at green, you're fine. And also each clan has their own specific population count and their own specific manpower that they can draw from. It's important. It's not super relevant to know just for now, but it is important just to recognize. So yeah, I think that's basically all of like the top-down stuff you need to understand before you start playing. One other thing I will say is that even though you can pillage holdings, like that's what this is telling me right now, like I can pillage some holdings if I want to. But the other thing you can do is that you can just create vassals like anyone else. You know, it'll give you a certain amount of money per year. It's probably good for taxes. It's pointless to do it on like fortresses. But if you do it for like temples and cities, you can get a pretty good tax revenue. Anyways, I'm gonna move to a smaller realm just so that I can show you how you would expand and how you would like start to get the ball moving on actually building like a nomad empire or whatever. I picked a deliberately smaller region just because I feel like this is what a lot of people want to do. Just like expand out a realm, see what you can do, try to get into like growing a kingdom or an empire or whatever, but just as like a nomadic government type. We have a population of like around 5,000. We have a few hundred manpower. And you can see that we have a horde of 500 troops. We could actually form another band of troops if we wanted to right now. I'm not sure if that's super necessary right now, but I'll see. Yeah, I might just create like a light rider horde just to have it. So basically that's how you gain troops. Like you use land in order to get horde troops, and then you can choose a specific type dependent on like what you happen to have. So a couple things about the situation. It's just like dealing with like power politics everywhere else. Try to ally with like strong regions, like the Uyghurs especially are breathing down our necks over here. And you want to see where the opportunities are for like attacking weaker kingdoms. I'm thinking he is relatively weak. I know that he has a vassal, so not as weak as he looks, but he is like the weakest person around here. I actually have a couple of kids, which is useful because I want to form some alliances like right away. This would give me a non-aggression pact with the Uyghurs. This is good. Hopefully I'll be able to form an alliance. If for whatever reason I'm not, I'll just roll over and die. Like, I don't know. Now, it's also just like any other game of Crusader Kings. Like, you can form up with like the bigger, more important kingdoms, but like, don't forget about the vassals within those kingdoms, because sometimes these people are like stronger than the actual people who are leading them in like a weird, contradictory way. So like, just look for anyone and everyone who's like willing to form up with you. After you exhaust all those options, then it's time to start plotting. Also, I would recommend that you try to do the thing where you find everyone who's like a capable commander or even like a capable diplomat or whatever, and just like invite them to your court, see if they can help out in something. Because you mostly win like through just like battles and stuff, commanders are like especially important to like get good ones for. Okay, this is good. This is good. We have a couple of alliances going, which is like super strong in this game. I don't know how else to emphasize it more. And now I think our closest neighbor who's like vulnerable, probably you, also because you're defending against like 30 other people. Yeah, you are just getting rolled from like all sides, like every side. You're defending against the conquest of a couple of territories, which is perfect because that means that I can swoop in and try to do something. I could try to invade. I think that's sort of a stupid idea. I think conquesting a territory that's near me is probably a better idea. The good thing about being a nomad is that you actually have like a fair amount of access to like different areas of the map. So you're defending for Beptala, which is all the way over here, and Sarsu, which is right next to it. I might as well go for the capital, you know? I might as well declare war for Turkey. And again, the thing that's important about these wars is getting your troops together. You basically just need to like fight their troops, and that's how you win. At this point, I'm basically just waiting for this army to finish. I am calling both of these troops over. I'm sure I'll be able to get people on my side soon enough. Like I can look for them coming. They're really far away. They're so far away, but they will be here at some point. More importantly, their army is so screwed. Like I really don't know what they're gonna do. I could try to catch them because I think they're gonna come up here. I mean, their army is like weak enough right now to the point where I could probably capture them and win pretty quickly. What I'm gonna try to do is I'm gonna try to get them to come to my capital. I'm just gonna psych them out until they're locked into my capital, and then I'll try to attack them. Wasn't fast enough. God damn it. This is where it's gonna happen. I guess that's not where it's gonna happen. This is the worst part about fighting these armies, just like trying to maneuver the troops and stuff. Okay, so this battle, pretty easy. You know, I played it very carefully. That one actually wasn't worth anything because I guess it wasn't his army or something. I can try to go find him if I want. I think that was just his vassal or something. I mean, he's my marshal. He's not that great. I think I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna try to imprison him. And then since I have him imprisoned, I can banish him, gain a bunch of money for doing basically nothing, and then just find someone else who's good enough. Let me try to invite someone, I suppose. Here's his main army. This is important. This is his main army. if we win this fight, this is going to be pretty huge. And I want to get here first because I think these people are going to try to join in. I am actually going to spend some money to invite you over just because you're really good and I have the money at this point. Anyone else who's willing to join, you're pretty good. I could use you as someone. Yeah, just try to invite people. Getting the right people is pretty important, especially when battles matter like this much. All right, so we have a 23 commander. We have an 8 commander and a 9 commander. Their traits aren't the best, but I mean, compared to me, they're good. So let's see. We have a pretty good chance of winning just because we have more troops. It's sort of just like every other battle. Like if you have more troops, you will just win the fight. And then after that point, it's just a matter of, you know, winning as many battles as possible to get up that war score. And then just occupying the territory that you're going for, which you do, by the way, just by standing on it. Like that's the thing you do. Unless there's an actual holding, like it's a capital or something. But if you just stand on a territory, that's how you occupy it. I think you can build a fort if you're not a nomadic government type. I'm gonna try to attack this army just so that they don't form up with each other and become stronger, which I am gonna do just by feigning a movement over here, not committing to it, waiting for him to get the lock, and then trying to meet him over here. Wait for the lock and then go meet him. That's how you have to do things. All right, that gave us no war score because, again, that's just, you know, his friend. I will meet him over here though. As long as he gets the lock showing up. Yeah, that was pretty simple. Again, as long as you can, oh look, there's my ally showing up after 100 years. Nice to see you. It's so nice that my friends are finally showing up. Something else I can do is I guess I can take this territory. Okay, so he did the thing. He formed up with his vassal. He's gonna come over here. We're gonna have a big fight, which is perfect because this is exactly the moment when my friends are showing up. So this is actually sort of perfect. I could run in there and try to lock them into place here and then wait for people to form up on me. To me, that sounds a little bit risky because I could just lose that fight pretty quickly. So they're gonna be here soon on the 20th. Okay. Now I feel confident that I can either try to meet them up there, or if they're not gonna go that way, try to meet them just right over here. There we go. And this should be a pretty effective fight at getting us some good war score. You really want those allies to come in and help you out, because if you don't have them, like, they get strong. Your enemies get strong. And then I'm gonna take their... Oh, I was beaten to it. I was just beaten to it. Did you see that? I suppose I'm gonna wait. I'm just gonna wait and try to fight them somewhere. I might as well take this. Okay, there we go. There we go. Look out for this. If you, like, declare war for a specific area, but it's occupied by someone else, and you enforce demands, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work if it's occupied. I don't know, just be careful with that. But that was pretty good. We gained some prestige for that. We also managed to get our friends to join in. I mean, that was pretty successful. I'm still pretty weak, but that's generally the gist of like how wars go between nomads. You have a Mongolian revolt. I can join it and then not really do anything about it. Just because I don't want to lose all of my troops just trying to deal with that. So he can handle it. It's totally fine. Something I can do is I can afford another horde, and I can afford a higher quality one. I might even want to get like some horse archers or something. Costs a fair amount of money. This one costs piety, light cavalry, and special horse archers. I think I'll go for this one. That sounds good. Okay, so here's the interesting thing. Clans want more land. There is a clan land demand. So something that I might want to do, and this is a very useful thing. I didn't talk about this before because it just wasn't relevant. Something that I am going to do is I'm going to split the clan, and I'm just going to give them Turgay, with the eventual idea being that I'll just give them all of this territory. But you do that just so that you avoid the clans want more land thing, because that's what happens when you like sprawl a lot, right? Like you have to divide up your land evenly. And in doing so, you actually get a vassal who gives you some number of troops. As long as you can keep them happy, it's very useful and very good. I'm also going to give you this territory because who cares? You like me more. I'll also give you a seat on the council. You can be the marshal. That's totally fine. And then I'll make the person who was just the marshal a commander. And I can also form a blood oath for as long as both rulers live. which is useful. You want that just so that they don't feel like they want to revolt or anything. You also want to keep them happy just by giving them titles and offering them stuff whenever you can. Giving them money, good. And again, this acts just like a normal vassal. They have a certain number of troops. You can call on them whenever a war starts. It's pretty useful. It's good. Just look at this screen. We have an alliance right now, so this line is green. The clan likes us because we're blood brothers. We're the same faith. He's a loyal clan. And he has his own number of population and his own number of counties. So we're good. We're stable right now. Now, we need to start looking for other opportunities for expansion. Sort of slim pickings around here. We could try to fight you. You have one vassal. You have one clan. So I think we should try to go for that. I need to have more population to invade somewhere. Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, so it's interesting. It's sort of like its own unique currency type. And it doesn't matter for a lot of things, but what it does matter for are these specific, like, invasion CBs. I don't know. I mean, it's cool. It's fun. It's a different thing. In general, like, just try not to let how different it is intimidate you too much. Because it is a fun thing, just like doing this stuff. I only have 9 unused manpower, which isn't great. Sometimes you don't want to use up all of your manpower at once, just so that it comes back faster. But that's just like super min-maxy stuff. Like, I wouldn't worry about that too much. One thing I did just notice right here is that we do have a city. We could, you know, revoke it and then just like pillage it to the ground if we really needed like the money or whatever. But if you look over at our title, like, you can see the city tax. Just from having one city is more than having like all of these nomad holdings. So keep cities around. Like, you don't need to pillage every single holding. I need this piece of territory. So I'm gonna call in everyone who I can, which should include my new vassal, I think, theoretically. Yeah, and we'll see how it goes. I don't know. I'll go meet up on him just to see. Now, when you call people to like join you in wars and stuff, you do want to press this button just to make sure that they actually come to you. I don't know. I mean, it's worth trying it. Sometimes they just have the power to ignore it. Oh shoot, I want to fight this battle. Hang on, go back. My wife just died right now of gout. Okay. Maybe I can form another alliance with someone. Okay, I'm gonna form this marriage. I'm gonna get a non-aggression pact. Theoretically, I'll be able to turn that into something else at some point. Okay, so it's good that we're doing this war now, because these allies are gonna join in like as soon as they can. Paranoid. You need to be paranoid. This battle would have been more risky if these guys chose to join in. I guess they just decided not to. But yeah, this battle should give us a fair amount of war score. That's pretty good. And then I just want to go handle these dudes so that they're not just running around doing nothing over here. We're gonna meet you right here. This is perfect. Because we have more troops. We're meeting them in a pretty advantageous spot. I was worried for a second. And then as long as because we're trying to take this plot of land, as long as we just sit here and just like wait for a second, I think we should be able to win this war. Nope, that's 98. Yeah, I mean, let me just take one piece of territory, and I think I should be able to win after that. Okay, let me just siege this down. Pretty simple, 100%. Now we have this territory. All right, and I think that sort of shows you the basic gist of like how you play as a nomad, how you expand your empire, how you really get things moving on just like playing as a nomadic government. Let me know if you have any more questions in the comments. I'll be happy to answer any of them. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.